Hello and welcome everyone to the virtual conference on innovation opportunity for fintech startups by Entrepreneur India. I'm Preetima Bhardwaj, Project Head, Webinars at Entrepreneur India. Today's discussion will revolve around the next big opportunity, trends for fintech startups. The agenda to be discussed during the session is how fintech startups should look at ways to connect, innovate, disrupt the financial services industry further. Let me start by laying out the ground rules for our attendees. The discussion will go on for 1 hour, 15 minutes. This will be followed by a Q&A session for the next 15 to 20 minutes. If you have any questions during the course of the discussion, you can post them through the Q&A option at the bottom of your screen. Mention in your question if it is directed at any specific panelist. We will take up questions post the panel discussion. Please participate in poll during the webinar. We would also like to request the attendees to keep the questions within the scope of the discussion here today and not pitch their businesses. Let me now introduce our panelists for today. We have with us Siddharth Pai, founding partner 314 Capital, Mithun Sundar, CEO, Lending Card Finance Limited, Meghna Suryakumar, founder and CEO, Credit Watch, Dina Jacob, co-founder, CFO and Head Revenue and Growth, Open Financial Technologies Private Limited, Shishank Mehta, Director, Product Strategy, Razorpay, and Mr. Satyam Kumar, co-founder and Executive Director, LoanTap Financial, who will be joining us in next 5 to 10 minutes. Our session moderator for this session is Saurabh Kumar, Editor, Special Project, Entrepreneur India. Let me now introduce Ms. Ritu Maurya, the Editor-in-Chief of Entrepreneur India and Asia Pacific, who would give the welcome note. Over to you, Ritu.
Thank you very much, Preetima, and a very good morning to all the entire community of FinTech which is present over here today. I see that we have some great participation and also a stellar panel of speakers from the FinTech industry who are now going to set the entire digital side of finance into movement. Now, what do I see from an editor's lens? I see that FinTech today is a key enabler of financial services, not just in India, but pretty much around the globe. I see the biggest movement happening in the future of payments, which was always very large. It was happening, it was always growing, but I see it going forward, becoming all the more omnipresent when it comes to its growth. It's like whether it is digital wallets or whether it is contactless payment or whether it is NFC-enabled smartphones, that is absolutely going to be the future. I also see cloud-based POS as a big opportunity, particularly from an e-commerce and retail perspective going forward. On a larger scale, and if I were to take FinTech or an extended FinTech view, I would say robo-advisory, particularly for wealth advisory services, is something I'm very excited about. I think digital advice is going to become a prerequisite for pretty much every wealth management firm which is trying to serve the mass market today. The adoption of contactless payments will be rising, particularly post-COVID, as people will be more scared of handling money. Money lending, of course, which had started by fintech players on digital basis, is again going to see a big rise, and peer-to-peer money transfers is going to be very big. One thing which I would love to see in India, particularly from fintech startups, is digitizing the international remittance processes. Not that it is already not happening, it's happening in a big way, but I think we need some kind of blockchain technology for enabling this remittance process rather than going through the traditional third-party approach. And certainly omni-channel offerings, the framework of digital payments to provide seamless customer experience across channels, is something that is looking very big. On the whole, I think it will be a mix of technical skills, capital investments that will go in, government policies, the regulatory framework, how it pans out, and the entrepreneurial mindset, which will really be the driving force of FinTech going forward. So we have, as I said, a stellar panel, and I'll give it over to Saurabh to actually pick out some great points today and actually lay out what will be the future of FinTech opportunities in India. Over to you, Saurabh.
Thank you, Ritu, and good morning and welcome everyone to this webinar on Entrepreneur India. Today, we are going to talk about innovation opportunities for the FinTech space. Definitely, there are many spaces which get affected, but this is one space which I believe has one of the greatest opportunities available during these times also to come out winners. But for that, I believe that the first and very important thing that is required is an institutional help, which is the backbone for any economy to nurture its startups and fintechs or any kind of businesses. So I'll straight away go to Siddharth. And Siddharth, if you can first tell me that till now, whatever announcements that we have heard from the government in terms of helping the startup ecosystem, specifically in the fintech space, do you think they are enough or do you think we need more?
So I think what the first priority of the government was to actually ensure that 800 million people, 800 million Indians who would be vulnerable to COVID-19 were taken care of. During the course of their presentation, when asked what they're going to do for businesses and SMEs, the finance minister announced that they would look into it. It's been more than a month since that particular announcement, but we haven't seen any amount of measurable relief actually given to SMEs or to the fintech players. What the RBI has actually done as of now is that the RBI has actually unleashed this quote-unquote bazooka of 3.74 lakh crores. By actually reducing the CRR, by actually starting the TLTRO operations and everything else that they've done so far. But see, what India is facing, and this is an institutional problem, is that there's a large amount of transmission loss that actually happens. Because the transmission loss happens wherein the RBI actually releases all these particular goodies all the way to the banks, but the banks are reluctant to do any amount of lending. Now, credit in India has traditionally been the bastion of NBFCs, who actually do the last mile of credit financing. Ever since the IL&FS crisis of September 2018, what we've seen is a marked reluctance from the market to actually accept the NBFC framework as a whole. It's because of this that Indian businesses, SMEs, and everyone are still reeling from a huge cash deficit. We have not seen enough participation from the government to ensure that SMEs are actually been taken care of. All the other countries across the world have actually taken up relief measures up to 10% of their GDP, whereas India's relief measures so far from the government have actually been a paltry 0.85%. It is important that the government actually takes its in force and actually starts utilizing the institutional frameworks that we have across India to do it. And another thing that the government and RBI should look into is the fact that the current system has actually been broken. The transmission loss are extremely huge as of now, especially when it comes to the existing players of the larger banks, etc. This becomes a perfect segue for India's fintech players, which fintech has been the area which has garnered the largest amount of capital in India and seen the highest amount of growth. It's important for them to allow them to become part of the formal financial ecosystem such that any measures of the RBI can actually be actioned through the fintech startups of India and actually go and give the end result to all the customers and to the SMEs and the businesses as well, thereby reducing the entire transmission loss in the entire system.
Okay. So talking about NBFCs, and which is also affecting some of the credit players in the fintech space also, don't you think that the track record of NBFCs as they came about, and that is what even banks having money are not are reluctant to actually collaborate with the NBFCs. So what would be the sweet spot where both can collaborate so that the other fintech players who are there are getting affected do not get affected?
So see, what has happened is we need to understand that the banking system has actually become a regulatory moat as of now. It's actually become impossible for, it's almost near impossible for anyone to get a banking license to actually become part of that entire ecosystem. So the banks have in effect actually become gatekeepers to this entire part. In order for startups and NBFCs to actually get part of that entire ecosystem, NBFCs to be deeper integrated, RBI needs to start treating NBFCs with a lot more kindness and consideration than what it's actually been doing in the past. What we've seen since IL&FS, they've actually showed a studied reluctance towards accepting the NBFC framework for whatever reason. And these NBFCs have actually become systemically important NBFCs as well. So unless the NBFCs become part of the formal framework, the RBI starts directly extending its largesse to these particular NBFCs rather than trying to go to the banks as it's always been doing. We will see this particular thing continue over time. What India should do and the RBI should look at very clearly is the fact that the digital banking norms need to actually come into the forefront as of now. Singapore has done tremendous work in ensuring that they have actually come out to the forefront. They've been one of the first countries in the world to explore a universal digital banking license. And what COVID-19 has taught us is that the physical banking infrastructure is not that important for a business to actually conduct its operations as a whole. Actually, we have Dina from Open as well. They've done tremendous work in actually ensuring that SMEs and all can actually directly integrate with their banking accounts and start getting greater flexibility. These are the kind of innovations, a neo-banking revolution we're seeing. RBI should actually accept them, classify them as digital banks and allow them to become the last mile players as well. The moment this happens, the transmission loss of close to 3.74 lakh crores, which has now been stuck in the financial system and the banks. We've seen the deposits rise anywhere between 15 to 30% in March alone. We can actually ensure all that money actually starts transmitting toward the economy, and we won't be stuck in the situation we are in as of now.
Okay. Thank you, Siddharth. So I'll come to Dina. Dina, I think you would want to talk about this, that, you know, when Siddharth says that, you know, new banking and all that, we accept it. What's your view there?
Right. So, Siddharth pointed out a very important aspect in the relevant for the current times. In fact, what COVID-19 has done is to act as a catalyst in pointing out the importance of contactless, digitization, everything in fintech. So we are in Neobank started in 2017, and I still remember the early days wherein there has been a whole lot of friction from the entire ecosystem in terms of, you know, this requires a lot of API or other, you know, infrastructure sharing. It requires, you know, banking infrastructure being opened up and being mature, all of that from a tech perspective. So as we have seen that evolution, there has been, we were already at a point wherein things were changing in the right direction. And I would say COVID-19 has catalyzed or accelerated that whole pace. Today, in the last 1 month, the kind of changes we have seen, just to give you a few statistics on how things we have seen when everything was falling apart all across, we've seen almost 20% increase in the kind of acquisition at a 40% of the marketing budget. Of course, we have cut down on that. And then we saw a whole lot of interest in the API banking that was coming in inbound, which was not our immediate focus at this point in time. We were focused on SMEs and giving them a complete full-fledged platform with the entire neobanking spectrum of services, including the payment stack and the recording compliance aspects, coming to the card issuance with an expense management, and then coming to the demand generation part also. But that being said, what we have seen is API banking gaining relevance because, you know, businesses started having this pressure of getting into the digital era, or rather, you know, digital channel, and that's not completely ready elsewhere today. So we started seeing, you know, we could put together different parts of the assets we have built to solution it in a totally different manner. That was another emerging trend in the last 1 month. That even with banks also, we've seen more banks opening up to the whole idea of sharing and taking to the community. So I would say the what got brought down was working in silos. Everybody is open. The entire ecosystem has come together, open to collaboration. And the smallest friction we have seen, while customer experience is at the core of what entire neobanking and all this infrastructure and sharing does, what we see as a friction also is a small little requirement of the physical documentation, be it on the account opening part. I know that, you know, from government also a lot of push is happening on breaking down those frictions. Yet at the same time, it is a need of the hour to push through, right as mentioned at the beginning, for the cross-border payments for that matter, be it trade finance for that matter. So that is where businesses started struggling during this period.
So you think that after, as I was discussing that, you know, earlier also the established financial institutions, banks, to be honest, when these fintech players came, they bought out wallets and all, they tried to wage a war, but then they could not. So then they gave up. And now do you think there is going to be another round where a lot of collaborations in terms of these institutions working with innovative product companies would be something that we would see from here on?
Yes, I think it opens up a huge window for the collaboration, and we have all opened up and warmed up to that whole idea. So that has been, you know, it is a evolutionary process, right? Initially, we try to take each person's solution to the market. And this is such a vast market and so many things to be tackled, as Siddharth mentioned, right? If government is announcing something, how do we take it to the right deserving set of people? How do we identify that? How do you create channels to get there? So the existing infrastructure working in silos is not solving that problem. And the problem doesn't have, we don't have the luxury of like 2-3 years to solve for that. So these are the times wherein, you know, heightened collaboration. For example, when we work with a bunch of, you know, the entire fintech ecosystem, a whole lot of players are plugged into what we do. And they are also, you know, taking this, I wouldn't say free time. So currently there is bandwidth apart from the core product. Everybody is taking a step back and looking at listening to the users, listening to consumers, listening to the problem and the complexity of the evolving times that we are in. Habit change, behavior, the digitization, all of that shift which is happening. Everyone is taking a step back and looking at how can I collaborate play on my strengths and take the right solution to the market rather than reinventing the wheel. So that way we are working with the entire ecosystem players, right? From, you know, banks wherein we are providing co-branded enterprise versions to, you know, there are fintechs whom we are collaborating and helping their clients have their own, you know, viable models, which they can take as an entire neobanking offering to the customers, which helps helps them, you know, value add to the customers. And we are directly giving to the SMEs with the, including a user experience and the journey, everything crafted by us. So even for us, it has been a time of reinventing ourselves, the way in which we take this entire thing to the market. While building a stack, how do you open up so that people can benefit out of it, including the fintech players?
Shashank, I'll come to you when it comes to, like, we talked about, you know, breaking silos and evolving products and all. So how do you see this space, and how, what has been your observation, especially in the last 1 month? Has the attitude changed, or have you been able to reach out to more people and talk about products that how we can evolve, especially when, you know, contactless is something that we should think about?
Definitely. So I think what Dina and Siddharth also kind of talked about, right, the banking flows changing. There's a clear-cut ask from the market that's coming out for more product-based flows. You know, if you look at any of these things in the past, very simple things like salary processing. There are a lot of companies right now which are still operating in the manner where the salary is printed onto a letterhead. It's signed by the authorized signatory, handed over to the bank official who then does the salary processing. And these companies are now finding that this is no longer possible. This is becoming a pain from them because the banking officials also cannot reach your house easily. Even if you look at various angles like how data sharing would be done with the CA firm for your taxation, the way this was being done was that the person from the CA firm would come to your office, sit in your office, look at all the documents, do your TDS filing and all the taxation, right? Versus what we are seeing now from the market is a very clear-cut demand because of the realization that everyone has that we should be able to run our business from wherever we are. We should be able to run our business through our laptop versus requiring physical contact for anything. And because of this, we have seen a very large rise in interest in the recent times for our payroll solution, particularly in terms of how companies can very quickly process payroll and without having to, you know, give any kind of a file to a banking official. How do you do those angles? Things like compliance payments, your TDS payments, can it be done through an online channel easily without having to kind of create, again, a file being done, physical verifications happening in the office, etc.? How do you digitally do it? So in general, I think in terms of how the product flows are changing, there is clear-cut demand from the market that we need solution for today's agent time. I think we all would accept that this COVID situation is not going to you know, end, and things will not go back to as they were, let's say, in Jan-Feb in about another month's time or so. That's probably not going to happen. A lot of the things are going to be impacted for quite a significant amount of time. So in terms of the payment side of things, we are seeing a significant rise in solutions like EPOS. Which was earlier seen a spike during demonetization period. We had built this solution back in 2016 when the demonetization happened for an EPOS collection, that whether instead of you collecting cash from the person, you take an online payment, even though you're, let's say, near to the person. And grocery companies, for example, they're delivering in a lot of areas where, let's say, people don't have their debit cards even enabled. RuPay debit cards, for a lot of them, were switched off because they were not used for a long time. So the ask of the market now is, how do I collect these payments without requiring cash? And most of the grocery companies have stopped taking cash because of the contact nature. So we've revamped our EPOS application now, and we have launched it again in the market with brand new set of features. And I think that's what the market is clearly asking. In terms of general product strategy, I think while there is the COVID lens that we have to look at, there's also a strong lens that we have to see from the perspective that clients are now, you know, focusing more on survival. They are no longer looking for optimization products which are optimizing few parts which are not in the critical flow. They're looking for things which is going to help their company survive this over the next 6 to 8 months. So the amount of USP that your application should be able to provide to them, the ask is increasing. They are no longer going to take, let's say, an MVP which has, let's say, bare bones feature. It does the job, it does one thing well, but it is not providing enough depth. What in earlier times you could possibly launch an MVP, do marketing exercises around it and get good amount of traction. I think now everyone is more focused on survival, which means that any solution that they are picking up, they need to be more thought through. It has to be more sorted, and it really needs to solve the problem of survival. How do I help my business run during this time? So that's the lens that needs to be taken, I think, across companies when they look at how their product strategy is to be framed over the next few months.
So I think robo advisory and these kind of things are going to be more prevalent.
Definitely. Definitely. So I think we have a capital arm also, and we also have a lot of lenders who give out their loans through our disbursement platform. And what we're seeing is that clients are now coming to us asking that I don't know which lender is lending in the market. I have an immediate requirement and I don't have the time to talk to 10 different lenders to figure out who can give me at what rate. Can you as a company help me out in this time and give a quick turnaround time? So robo advisory, as you pointed out, is a very relevant thing. That how do I get the value that I need in as short a time versus earlier times when I would kind of do shopping around, I would talk to various lenders, I would kind of figure out who's giving me better rate. I need the loan right now, and people probably are willing to give in a little few points extra in terms of interest rate as long as they can get the right support at the right time.
So talking about lending, so this is one more arm of banking, which lending is something that one more thing that we would have to talk about, is because at this moment in time, a lot of loan takers are not able to pay back, and that's kind of hurting a lot of lending there. So I would come to Satyam, to you, to how have you seen this period evolving since we have been hit by the crisis in terms of the repayments, and what are the learnings that you're going to take forward, and the people who plan to have these kind of businesses should understand. You'll have to unmute yourself.
Thank you. Thanks, Saurabh. So a couple of themes are uniform and across the industry, and cost cut is one such theme, whether it's a government or whether it's individual or an institution. Cost cut has been uniform, that has been practiced across the industry and startups or non-startups both put together. Moving on from there, what we are also seeing is that a couple of stuffs which is also emerged very clearly, that when it comes to doing an emergency support system, government has relied more and more on the startups, be it in a health tech domain, be it into grocery domain or a global domain. So the startup has come as a main theme in the whole fight around the COVID. Similarly, coming back to the fintech, how do we see the fintech operating? Lots of railroad in the fintech, being into the acquisition, payment or accounting side or the lending side, the railroads have been made. What we'll be seeing is, we'll be seeing more and more collaboration, cohabitation between the institutions. And as an institution, we are also preparing for that wave to come in all over again. So kind of speeding up of adoption, we saw post demonetization in the payment space. The same kind of a speed we'll see in the lending space, because all the businesses will look forward to restart ASAP. All the institutions will look forward to start ASAP. Individuals will look forward to restart their life. And the speed will be of essence over there. Having talked about a speed and building the railroads around it and a collaborative environment around it, what we also see, Saurabh and everyone, is that, post-COVID, as we very clearly see from the way government have been approaching, there is still lack of clarity or a lack of planning around how the lockdown will be eased out. In this kind of an unpredictable environment where you are seeing things to stretch maybe 6 months, 3 months, 12 months, depending upon I'm seeing some changes in this. Yeah. When we see the government to lacking the planning on the lockdown easing, and that is where we see that speed will be needed, both in terms of entering the market, delivering the product, and coming out of the market, because you will have India, you'll have to see India in a multiple pocket. Some pocket will peak in May, some pocket will peak maybe later June, some pocket may see a climb back of the COVID in some other month. So the institutions has to come very quickly to the market, deliver the product, meet the market demand, and come out of it with least of the trouble or least of the scratches. So the speed of delivery will be very important, and the platform which has been built by FinTech will help or will become a collaborative environment even for the larger institutions like a bank or a large balance sheet NBFCs to play in the market. So both, one, in terms of the demand to be met, and the second, the speed with which it has to be met, and the third, with the operational efficiency of going into the market and getting out of the market in the situation that the trouble will begin again, is all three or four variable has to be looked at. So we are looking at a COVID more like a Kaliya Naag kind of environment, where you have a multi-headed snake, which will come in. So one snake taming at one head, taming at one end, is not giving to give you a solution unless until you get a clear-cut medicine, or you get a clear-cut stuffs like vaccination. Till the time, this problem is going to live. Okay. And then it is about the speed. So at the same time, all of us also have to earn a livelihood. So for earning a livelihood, we have to cohabit the environment of COVID, go into the market, do business, come out, do the product delivery, essential or non-essentials, and come out. Because after a quarter, every item will become essential. Today, we are looking at only as a grocery, as an item, as an essential. Within a quarter, you will see every part of our life to turn into essential. And the delivery railroad is what FinTech is in a position to provide. And that's where we'll see the adoption cohabitation happening.
I just hope that we don't have to cohabit with COVID. I hope that it goes away. But I think I'll come to Meghna before I go to Mithun about lending. I think you wanted to add something about the banking, the thing that we were speaking about.
Sure. So how we look at this problem is, it's not just COVID alone. You know, when ILFS collapsed, a year and a half ago, we sort of got into an economic recession. So there's a threefold problem at this point, right? There's a recession which we thought we'll come out of, which we thought was bottoming out, but we had the COVID, so it's extended the recession and made things worse. We have the COVID situation, and we don't expect to see a vaccine in, you know, maybe 8 to 12 months, we would have a vaccine. And the third thing is, now there's this fluctuation in the, oil prices. Because of this, you know, there is a lot of stress in the market, both on the demand and supply side. So from our perspective, if you look at the situation right now, equity is a very expensive form of capital. So how are companies and businesses going to raise money to survive, right? So we feel that debt is going to become the new equity, and debt is going to become the cheapest option for companies to survive, to have liquidity, to be able to have working capital to survive and weather through this crisis. So from that perspective, we feel that the lending industry, the financial services industry, is going to play a very crucial role to help businesses, especially small businesses, try to survive this crisis. And the moratorium of a 90-day period for your loans for MSMEs and some of the additional support is a step in the right direction. It's not enough, but they need to do more. So we see a lot of shift in the lending industry because of this. Maybe while digital lending and SME lending was under 1 crore, it was completely digital. If you look at the 85% of the credit outstanding in India today, that was not lent using digital processes. It was done using manual processes, paperwork. So there's human touch everywhere, from collection of documents to processing to interaction. So that is going to see a huge shift post-COVID because of the risk that people cannot take. An entire lending industry per se needs to look at going digital. And that's a huge opportunity for the fintech industries and for fintechs to, support the entire financial services ecosystem across sectors and across shapes and sizes of loans. Whether it's a 10,000 crore loan or a 5 lakh loan or a 100 crore loan, everything is going to go digital. Video KYC, which is the right move that happened in March, that is going to become very important. So digitization is going to happen in every step of the lending flow. We've already seen that kind of happening in the past 60 days when we've seen like a rush of large banks reaching out to us to help them digitize their entire lending process end to end with our platform. So that's, I think, a huge shift and opportunity for fintech companies to support the industry. And of course, like everybody said, collaboration is important, that everybody work together to kind of create different kinds of new offerings, products and services. For example, like Canara Bank, some of the PSUs have come out with extending the current working capital for MSMEs from 10 to 35% without any additional collateral. And I think that's a huge relief for them to get access right now. And that's what some of the PSUs are doing, right? So for people to collaborate and come and offer different kinds of products and financial services to SMEs and MSMEs, you know, and to help them, you know, weather through this crisis, again, will be a huge opportunity that everybody can capitalize on, especially the fintech industry. So that's kind of our view.
Avithun, I'll come to you now. So, from the lending point of view, how do you see this period right now? And do you think at this period, because I've heard from various experts that right now people should avoid debt and should be preserving cash and spending their money. So how do you see this period evolving?
Thanks, Swarup, for the question. I think I would answer it in two parts, right? I think there is a period of the next 3 to 5 or 6 months, and then there's the period of, the next 18 months after that, right? I think, and let me say it from two perspectives as well. As a company, see, we are a medium-sized, I would say medium-sized, but we've at this point become systemically large. We are a medium-sized NBFC online digital lending platform, which is completely focused only on MSMEs in the country and which typically gives out working capital loans to the tune of about, on an average ticket size, about 5, 6, 7 lakhs, right? So these are given out to the mom and pop stores, the small and medium entrepreneurs, people who sort of buy the street corner in India and given out completely digitally with close to zero touch physically. That's been the business that we've been in. Now, for a company of this sort, which does this business, I think the next 2-3 months, the most important question is to be able to conserve cash through a mix of everything that different people have spoken about: cost cutting, prudence, thinking through postponing sort of commitments, but making sure that we are able to sort of manage our cash flow over the next 2-3 months as the bulk of the tightness of this situation passes through. Now, speaking for the next 12 to 18 months for the company, I actually think it's a different context altogether, right? Because the need for credit, especially the target segments that we are speaking to, is actually going to be much larger than it has been over the last 4 years when we've been in life. And from what I see of the ecosystem outside NBFCs, if I speak to banks and to all of the other institutions that I speak to, if anything, their ability to give credit, while they may have money to lend, their ability to be able to really think through and give the credit has actually become more marginalized. They're going to be more risk-averse to that extent, especially to MSMEs who are already underserved. I suspect they will be even more underserved unless the right digital fintech banking company sort of steps into this space. Today, MSMEs in the country, there are about 70 million MSMEs. Frankly, only about 10 to 12 million of them actually have ever had working capital loans from a systematic industry. I mean, they get it from the nearby mind often, but from a systematic industry in a simple, easy to access, clean, purely on the books kind of manner, very few have had access to them for a variety of reasons. Either their vintage is low, their time in the business is low, their size of business is low, company's ability or a bank's ability to verify their credit history. So for a lot of such reasons, right? And that's why these things happen. Now, if I remove the company view and I take the industry view, right, as to how does this look, I'll flip it completely, right? The next 3 to 6 months is probably where the requirement for credit is going to be the highest. Now, the reason for that may be a mix of factors, right? There are cash outflows which still continue for a medium-sized business during a shutdown period, and there's stuck working capital depending on the nature of the business, which is already stuck, and salaries need to be paid, and they need to sort of manage them through. So similar problems for them. As they sort of come back and the economy comes back, and when I say come back, I agree with some of the folks here who mentioned, Satya mentioned it, Siddharth mentioned it, I think that we are looking at least a 6 to 12 month period where there will be some version of coming back going on, right? Till we really get a vaccine and sort of come out of the problem entirely. I think as this comes back, these will likely be the businesses which come back to shape the fastest. And the reason I say that is, one, typically if you're servicing a nearby catchment localities sort of small and medium needs, be it a
bicycle repair shop, be it a guy who does computer repairs, be it somebody who's actually a vegetable grocer or a tailor. Typically, these people have ties in the community, and they are in a sense serving what we within quotes call medium essential industry. And so when demand comes back, they'll be the ones who are sort of the quickest, if you will, to recover. Number two, unlike a large company, their overheads and their costs during the transition period is lower as well. So if they manage to sort of stay prudent during this period in time, we expect that they should be able to come back to life fairly quickly. So I see this broadly, if I step back, for both NBFCs like us and for the MSMEs whom we serve, I think we've got a 3 to 6 month period where we all need to be extremely prudent and really manage cash flow. Coming out of it, I suspect MSMEs in this country, if with the right level of support, have an opportunity to rebound. And the need for credit, especially in a digital manner, is going to be significantly higher. The one piece that I think would make the biggest difference to this problem would be if we were to get significantly higher assistance for the MSME sector from the government. I think Siddharth spoke about country spending close to 10%, while our spend is sub 1% of GDP. And somebody else spoke about how Singapore has sort of set up the best system. I speaking to a friend of mine who runs a lending company in Singapore, and another friend who's actually a small entrepreneur in Singapore. And when they shut their business down, within the next day, the company actually received a check from the government with a certain amount, which was supposed to cover their 2 month expense. Right, that's the speed at which people are sort of processing. We're taking very, if I were to say at this point, the government's measures to sort of really support MSMEs haven't been adequate, and I think we need more.
But the experience with the banks, how is it been? I mean, the RBI announced some measures, so to ensure that, both credit goes out in the market. But can we see a backflow of money from the banks to the RBI, even at a small rate, but they're reluctant to, lend to NBFCs or whatever. So how has been your, what is your view?
Yeah, I think the moratorium is, in theory, a great idea, and we've been sort of keen to extend it to a lot of our customers, frankly, because they need it as well, right? What's not happened is full-scale policy clarity across the spectrum, right? It has not been a full flow-through on both ends of the spectrum. Now, when we sort of give moratoriums to several of our customers, for the right thing to happen would be the government to step in and make sure that, the banks that we borrow from, the financial institutions that we borrow from, also pass the same moratorium with the same levels of, clarity on how we treat, the loans during this period of time. I think while the intent has been right, as with India, a lot of transmission loss happens with most things, right? So the final implementation and making sure that last mile, every part of the chain is getting the same sort of relief from the government hasn't fully happened. And that's made it a little tougher to execute. All intention, I think everyone's intended right. But in times of uncertainty, the direction is not 100% clear. Capital follows the safest path, right? And that goes, as you spoke about, the reverse flow, which is not really helping the business in any way, shape, or form.
Siddharth, I'll come to you to have your view on this, especially. A lot of people are saying that debt is not the correct thing for the SMEs right now. What they need is support. So the RBI has tried its bit, but the banking system has kind of failed it. So what do you think is the impediment there?
No, I think, what usually happens is in times like this is that all of credit, like your entire banking norms, everything, et cetera, is based on risk assessment. Right about now, the risk is actually at the highest. So no banker can actually go about and actually give any of the loans or make any of the investments at this particular point in time. Another part that also needs to be taken into consideration is the fact that the NPA norms. Our banking system has been burdened with this legacy of NPAs for a very long period of time. And it peaked, I think, about 18 months ago, started coming down now, but it slowly started spiking up because of this as well. Now, for a large amount of banks, because of the tightened NPA norms and the Basel III norms that all the banks follow, the moment 4-5% of the loans actually go bad, there's actually a very strong chance that the entire equity base of the bank may actually be eroded at that point in time. So this is a systemic risk that the bankers also understand. Along with this, the RBI, with the moratorium, everything they put in, what they should have ensured is some of the NPA recognition norms, etc., across the entire banking system have actually been reduced to a larger extent possible. The RBI did some small bits and measures in this entire piece, but the larger cohesive piece that the nation actually needs as of now is important. Another point in this with regard to credit, in India, the problem we always had is a lack of credit. We've never been an over-leveraged society. We've always been a savings economy. as a whole. If you actually compare a debt to GDP ratio across all the countries in the world, we think by about 55%, if I'm not mistaken. Whereas countries like the US and Japan has a 256% ratio. The US is already, I think, about 110 as of now. China also has significant debt on its books as well. The problem India faces is a lack of credit. It's also a lack of affordable credit. The interest rates in India are actually far too high in order for businesses to actually borrow, in order for people to actually lend. We've all this time we've been fighting this myth of inflation. But if you actually look at the way India's calculated inflation for a long period of time, 42% of the entire basket is dedicated to food. In fact, I always say this, India is one of the few countries where the price of onion actually determines inflation. We've had the recent onion problem a few months ago. You saw the inflation actually spiked up to a large extent, whereas the rest of the goods that we actually do consume on a daily basis remain almost flat. So India needs to actually relook at its way of actually accounting for inflation so the interest rates can actually come down and wider, cheaper credit can be made available to a lot of people. Even the recent scheme by SIDBI as well for startups, it had 10.5% interest. The schemes that have actually come out in the US actually have a cap of about 3% of the entire interest. There are some businesses that are getting loans at 1% as well. When the interest rates across the entire system have actually collapsed, and even the RBI has taken a large amount of effort to reduce the repo rates, etc., the repo rates are now stand at about 4%, if I'm not mistaken, right? And the bank's cost of capital is actually around the same rate as well. But the banks are still lending at 12 to 16% to businesses. That entire spread of 8 to 10% is almost unheard of across the entire world. In India, businesses especially need larger access to credit. They need larger access to cheaper credit. And this actually requires the RBI and the government to actually look at the cost of capital in India, find ways to actually reduce that, and to actually broad-base it. The moment you concentrate credit in the hands of those few banks as well. See, what we've had is a credit concentration risk in India for a long period of time. There are about 15 to 20 banks, banks max, if you really want to extend it. They're actually become the credit providers to a $2.7 trillion economy of 1.3 billion people. It's unheard of across the entire world. We actually need broader participation over there. And we also need to realize that some of the banks that have become commercially unviable, and we have all of us that know which banks, some of them have even fallen, some of them have gotten bailouts, etc. Those particular banks should be allowed to sort of just be retired off, so to speak. And we need to allow newer players to actually come in, because the legacy costs of these banks have become so high that it becomes almost unserviceable. I think this particular situation wherein now actually gives India a chance to give, it's a reset for the entire nation. As we come out this crisis, no one knows when we're going to come out, how it's going to come out. It's important for us to actually start pursuing all these bold reforms. Because if we are to become a $5 trillion economy by the year 2025, unless we have these kind of bold reforms, unless we actually let loose the credit gates, unless we bring down the cost of capital across the entire nation, we will never be able to hit those particular numbers in our lifetime.
$5 trillion, that's a huge number. I think in any case, a very ambitious number, I would say. But we'll move on to some a different thing altogether. Is the financial services in general, like the products that we have? Shashank, I'll come to you for this. That we have been a very under-penetrated society, but now a lot of players, we see even players like Paytm and all also trying to become a fully financial services company, having all so innovation, product, this thing, and use of more technology, maybe blockchain, maybe artificial, I don't know, all these deep tech solutions. So what do you think is going to be the new kind of strategy for all fintech players from here on?
I think one of the major aspects is going to be that everyone, as I mentioned in the past, everyone is going to be focused on survival more than anything else. So I think the first aspect that companies are looking for is, how do I work still in this model? How do I work in this way that I'm kind of, during the COVID time, I can still survive? So the major thing that companies are looking at, and how finance companies are kind of also looking at solving the problems, is helping businesses switch over to mechanisms that can let them work during the COVID time the fastest. I think Dina had mentioned this aspect, right? That a lot of companies which have to do, let's say, foreign transfers, they can no longer depend on the older model. So how do companies switch over to mechanisms, give to these companies that you can make foreign transfers via an online mechanism versus requiring a physical signature model? So in terms of, I think, how everyone's kind of moving to the financial services, a simple way for me to actually talk about the basic requirement is that if any one of us over here has to find out when did I last pay a particular vendor any amount of money, I need to go to my bank account, I need to download an entire account statement, there's an Excel file, do a search in that Excel file for the name of the vendor, which most likely won't be there, there would be an account number, Then I have to find the account number of the vendor, and then I'll know when have I last paid this vendor. Nobody wants to be wasting time on this. This is an absolute waste of, you know, the talent that we have in our companies. And if you look at any finance team, it's a pyramid of their ask. At the bottom most is just transaction monitoring and transaction reconciliation. And still the problem, because it is the core thing, most finance teams are just spending time doing this. Just looking at if the money has come in, what money is due to me, what money needs to be paid out, just this aspect. The finance teams don't even get an opportunity to work on strategic levers like how can I help my company manage its cash flow better. They're just still working on their receivables, their cash flow cycles, etc. itself. And they're kind of burdened by these angles. So what even Paytm is doing, what RazorPay also is kind of doing, and a lot of companies are kind of looking at is figuring out how do we help these companies manage their finances in a significantly more efficient manner without requiring, you know, too many basics kind of being sorted. Like large companies, and we work with a lot of large companies processing, let's say, hundreds of crores of transactions on a weekly basis. They do the reconciliation on Excel sheets still. They download an Excel sheet from payment gateways. They download an Excel sheet from their own system. A person sits and matches it, identifies where are the places where there's a mismatch, and those mismatches are manually handled, leading to, let's say, 3 to 4 days before a lot of your anomalies, your finance anomalies are sorted. Now, these are all things which is no longer acceptable in today's time when people are trying to kind of make sure that their finances run as tightly as possible, their numbers are as closely monitored as possible. You can no longer depend on this human interaction solving out so many different pieces. And sadly, the fact of the matter is, given the strain on the businesses, you can no longer solve problems just by adding more people to your payroll, which has been generally the way that Indian companies have operated. That, okay, my volume has scaled up 10x, let me increase my company size by 3x, 4x. That's been the model. But given the financial strain on most companies, that is again no longer possible. Companies which have seen massive scale up, education sector has seen a massive spike in terms of volumes, can no longer just quickly go and add a lot of people on the payroll to manage these spikes. They need to kind of look at these technical solutions to manage it. An education company working through freelancers who are providing classes on their platform needs to be able to make payments to these people on time and on demand. Just like how a lending company needs to be able to disburse loans on demand and in an automated manner. So these kind of challenges exist across various industries. Grocery companies, when they do procurements from the actual farmers, they need to make those payments on time. A lot of these farmers generally wait for a lot of time before their invoices, which are not even invoices. These are generally standard bills that are given to them. And these are cleared. It takes a lot of time. Whereas what we need is money to kind of flow as quickly as possible. There are farmers that we have heard of some stories from our grocery players who particularly who are working in the agriculture economy side. Where the challenge is that there's so much distrust that's also coming out. The people are like, you need to give me my money now. Only then can I dispatch out the goods for you. Whereas earlier, they would be ready to work on a credit model where I allow you to kind of, you know, take the goods and then give me the money later. And we had companies come to us and say, I need to automate my procurement because I can no longer work on the older model. I'm not able to do my procurements if I'm not paying them on time. So what financial services and all these financial companies need to kind of do is help these companies evolve as rapidly as possible. And I think as a bunch of folks on the panel have already mentioned, right, the next 6 months is going to be the companies which are able to get back on their feet as quickly as possible are the ones who are going to prop up the economy. And the way that they are going to be doing is by changing some of their core flows. And finance is one of the last places generally where technology touches in a lot of companies. But now the need of the hour is that this happens as quickly as possible. So that's, I think, where the financial service companies like RazorPay and a bunch of others are playing the role right now in the market.
So what we're going to do is we'll continue the conversation by taking up some of the questions that we already have got from our attendees. We have a first question from Pradeep Bhatt. Can we have his audio, please? Pradeep Bhatt. I think we're not able to give to audio to Pradeep. Can we give the audio to Vibhor Tikia, please? Vibhor Tikia.
Hello?
Yeah, Vibhor. We can hear you.
My first question is to Mithun. Mithun, I'll just give a brief introduction. I have a We have a fintech lending startup which lends to the underbanked. I've worked closely with one of your colleagues as well, previous colleagues, Prabhakar. I had a startup, Zora, which sold to Wunik, and Prabhakar came to Wunik for a while. Now, the idea is when we were lending to the underbanked, what we are now going to experience is going to be a spate of, or we are planning to experience a spate of increased NPAs. We're trying to prevent that because we have both technology and touch as part of our ecosystem. How are you planning to overcome the spate of increased NPAs? Also, increasingly, there are articles coming out which are talking about VCs shying away from the fintech space as of now. I'll give you an example. What happened with us when we sold Zora to Wunik was at that time, vertical e-commerce was the flavor, right? So apparel e-commerce companies suddenly shot up, and very quickly, once the flavor ran out, they shot down, and they shut down, you know, like a pack of cards. Do you see that happening in the fintech space? Also, how do you kind of tackle that, get over that?
Thanks. I'm sorry, I didn't get your name when the question was being asked.
Vibhor.
Okay. Vibhor. Yeah, I saw the bottom box. So Vibhor, thanks for the question. Let me answer it from the reverse, right? Before I joined LendingCard, I used to lead revenue marketing and strategy and analytics for Mintra. So my earlier role was in the apparel e-commerce space as the vertical. So what you said makes sense. I think two parts of the picture. Number one, dissociate sort of the running trend from the performance of a specific company. I think these are two specific things that we will always have to look at in any sector. Right now, if I take the simple example of vertical e-commerce and apparel, multiple players have tried and failed, while a few have succeeded in finding a business model that works. Now, if you find a business model that works, apparel is the second largest profit pool in this country after grocery. And once you've found a model which actually works and can actually generate positive, EBITDA, you're home and dry because it is a very large market in this country and will continue to grow. And whether flavor of the season, VCs come in, VCs go out, if the model works, the model works. Grocery is a model that is still being cracked, right? While Big Basket has done really well, to do it profitably has not been as simple, and it's a model that's still getting cracked. Other verticals haven't cracked it yet, right? There are horizontal players who are large, but in electronics or et cetera, et cetera. So first thing is, what I see is, apart from what you see in a sector, the more important question is the performance of a company. And there are different companies that perform fantastically in any given sector. There are companies which perform broadly badly in any sector. Second piece, coming back to fintech and sort of flight of capital in terms of VCs, et cetera, from them, and how are we managing NPAs? My experience has been actually deliberately the opposite, right? I think, true, maybe about 6 months, 8 months back, the flavor of the season was to use the word fintech. And frankly, every company that was worth its salt was trying to actually become a fintech, right? I knew of a travel service provider who actually had to go into lending. So it looked like when you have a large enough profit pool, which in India, lending is a massive profit pool, and technically low entry barriers to trying it, right? I mean, digitally you can lend and you just have to collect, but you don't realize what the complexity of getting the full mix right is. Lots of people want to try their hand at it. There was a saying around 6 months back, and not saying, but you know, common joke in the VC circles, which said every company, you know, spends its time doing what its core business is as a startup for a really long time until they finally became a fintech, right? And Google was the best example of it when they eventually got to, Google Pay. So fintech is a place where the profit pools are large, relatively low barrier of entry if you're able to manage your cost of goods sold as cash, so lots of people enter. My experience has been the reverse. Right now, VCs are being very selective on who they back, but they're being very clear that the long-term potential for this market I'm using the term loosely, fintech is high. Fintech is a broad variety of things, right? Payments functions very differently from lending, functions very differently from investment, from, you know, transactions. So very, very different models altogether. If I speak purely about the lending industry, I think staying focused, putting your customer first, and finding a way to sort of really underwrite with knowledge will actually save you from whatever the NPA crisis is. We have now done 4 years where we've close to doubled in terms of our book every year. We've served largely the underbanked and the unbanked, but we've stuck to that one segment of 70 million MSMEs in this country. And we have created, with the knowledge of the 4 years, we've created an algorithm which helps us to proprietarily decide what is the right level of loan to be able to give to that person, what is the right tenure, and where will they be able to comfortably pay us back. Will that be Will there be a hiccup in that or a change in that due to the current scenario? Of course there will be. Do I predict everything algorithmically on what would I do with this current scenario? Not yet. So right now it's going to be a mix of, as you said, tech and touch, at least for 6 months, and we're going to have to work and see to it. Our level of prudence would probably go 2x up. Our level of growth would probably come half x down. And I think we're perfectly happy to sort of wait out the growth period and stay prudent for a bit. And so are the venture capital folks who we are speaking to and our own backers as well. Like, they're fairly confident about the model. And the question has been, are they willing to take a little longer patience curve, which I think everyone is now open to.
Thank you, Mithun. I think before I go to the next question, I would want to ask Tina and Meghna also that this last part of the question, that fintechs getting attention from VCs, before I go to Siddharth to get the final answer on it. So what has been your experience, especially to do part of the one? Do you think very shortly, if you can tell me?
Sure. So I think that this is a time where startups kind of have to be prudent. I think that the first 1.5 months during the COVID crisis, we did see that the VCs community was a bit more silent because they were focused on working with their own portfolio companies, looking at the way their runways were and supporting them to survive. Because the first 6 weeks of the crisis, everybody looked at their cash flows, their runways, and all the VCs worked with the existing portfolio companies to look at, who's got how much runway, who needs funding immediately, what's the urgency. So they were busy with that. But what we see in the next right now, it's changing. I think that if you can see the news every day, investments are happening. And I think that the VC community is kind of going to bounce back and start looking at lending, but the bar is going to be much higher. That means that business models that have a path to profitability that are solid, they would still get backing at this point of time. I think that the VC community is still active. There will be new deals, but it's only that the bar is going to be much higher for the next few months. So what I would tell all of the startups is, if you have existing VCs and who already supported you and you're running out of money, consider doing a flat round that will give you 12 months runway. Go back, deepen your product, achieve a few milestones, and then go back and do a larger round of funding 12 months from now at a much higher multiple. And that's what I would tell startups which are short of runway. That would be my piece of advice for them, to consider doing a flat round from the existing VCs. And for startups who have 18 months cash, just sit tight, focus on your product, deepen your offering, work with your customers, work on your model, and in another 6-7 months, everything would kind of bounce back. So that's kind of the situation. That's what we feel.
Thank you. Nina, very quickly. Unmute them.
I totally agree with Meghna. The factor we need to keep in mind is that VCs haven't gone off the market, neither have they stopped looking at the right models. So they are very actively looking at the right models. We still get inbound calls and interest to understand what it is. So the key is how to survive. I mean, currently the way in which it will be evaluated is that this is also a test of resilience, right? So who is a winner? Who is actively able to innovate and come out? Who is actively able to find out new revenue streams, survive, find a way to survive? And this is a true test of entrepreneurship also. So what one needs to keep in mind is, as Meghna rightly mentioned, look at different structures, be it flat round, down round, be it, the bridge round you can take, or debt you can look at. Whatever would be the case, to get yourselves afloat. And then be clear on what to start, what to continue doing, and what not to start also. Be very prudent in this time. So if you stay afloat, don't worry. VCs are there, capital is there. So it's more about your resilience during this time.
So that, any assurance?
No, happy to. So I think, as Mithun probably put it, VCs, lending companies, even for VCs, the inventory is actually the cash. So the moment that cash sits in the bank longer, it starts burning a hole in your particular pocket. So VCs haven't stopped investing as of now. Most of them have become more prudent when it comes to this. They've gone for they're no longer looking at companies who follow what I call the raise and raise model, where essentially they raise a large amount of capital and they burn or raise all that money within the span of 6 months, and they go back to the market and start raising again. So all those models have actually gone away, especially now when it comes to fintech. Fintech had actually become a fig leaf for a number of people, where they couldn't find anything else they could do. They would call themselves a fintech company and try introducing some element of it. All those fly-by-night operators are no longer going to be entertained by any of the venture capitalists. There's been a flight to quality and a flight to fundamentals. So as long as you can prove that as long as you prove that you that you've actually built up a sustainable book, your book isn't fiction, that you do understand you do understand the nuances of lending and how, more importantly, how to get the money back. All the VCs still actually have a large amount of dry powder. They will actually continue to invest in you and seek out these models actively.
The next question that we have is from Muthu Alagappan. Can we have the audio, please?
Hi, everyone.
Yes, please go ahead.
Hi, my name is Muthu. Good afternoon. I run a finance company that gives out loans for automobiles. And I operate in smaller tier 2 and tier 3 towns where people are not used to digital lending and digital transactions. So I have two questions. Post-COVID, would you think that digital transactions would increase in smaller towns in general, where people have limited access to smartphones, computers, etc.? And the second question would be, as a company, how would I go about building up my digital collections? That is payments through cards, banks, online payments, etc. Thanks.
Okay. Satyam, would you want to answer that first part of the question if you want?
Yeah, sure. So fundamentally, the vehicle sales itself will move more and more online. And as I was saying, that it's a adoption change for the people. So the companies, in China as well as globally, even domestic company, we work with leading electric vehicle manufacturers who never thought that they will think beyond dealership outlets. So and a good amount of bookings are happening on their online platform. So you need to you need to bring your dealers. Probably if you want to take more participation in the ecosystem, you need to bring your dealers or sellers on a platform. If you want to control the platform, create the platform, or participate with the controlling party over there. So the purchase will happen. And if the purchase is happening or selection is happening, then the finance will also will be triggered on the platform or in a digital interface, this thing. So the answer in nutshell is emphatic yes.
Shank, for the second part of the question, in terms of, in the smaller town, so will we see more innovations in terms of products that will get them more accustomed and used to using these kind of digital platforms?
I think if you look at the digital collections angle in general, right, I think the best strategy is to kind of cover everything. How we have seen lending companies kind of manage the collection pieces, they give as many options to the customer as possible. Right from, let's say, giving a web page where they can go and make an online payment. If there's an app, there's a payment option within the app itself. To giving, if let's say these customers are used to sending it the money as an NEFT transfer from their bank account, you give them a virtual account number on which they can transfer the money. Let's say if these customers are delinquent or maybe have forgotten to make payments, you send them reminders, but not just a reminder, but you attach a payment link along with it. And if, let's say, at the end of the day, if you are sending somebody to their home for collections angle, right, they are equipped with collecting the money in a digital manner through, let's say, an EPOS application. I think the way that digital collections has to be looked at is, and it has always been this case, and I think others on this call can also kind of confirm this angle, right, that you have to give every single avenue, because what you are looking to do is basically recover the money. That's the main thing that we are looking at. In terms of innovation, there are going to be hard challenges, especially for in areas where there are no smartphones. I think that's going to be one of the toughest things for any one of us to kind of solve, given that maybe they are not used to even using their debit cards that have been given with their basic savings account. They're used to the cash model, and cash fundamentally requires you to visit a place and withdraw money, right? I think what we probably are not taking into account over here is just the will of humanity to survive. And while I'm kind of saying this lightly, but this is, I think, one of the strongest force for all of us, that all of us and every single person is just kind of looking to survive. And if we are able to educate them during this time, if let's say the lending company, which is kind of doing a collection, is able to educate them that, hey, if you have a WhatsApp, you can actually make a payment. If you have, let's say, a smartphone, you can make a payment. If you are stuck with cash, here are some of the mechanisms that you can follow to safely withdraw money from ATM if the need is there. I think that education right now is very important, and kind of calming the nerves is very important. So I think collection is it's a game between technology, psychology, and different angles. And I think all of those have to be taken into account when you build a strategy. From a payments perspective, how it should work is that you need to give all the various options to your customers, whatever they are comfortable with. And that is the hard work that you have to do on your end. And when it comes to cash, I think primarily right now, sadly, the only way out is to kind of figure out and let them know of safer ways to withdraw cash if they just don't have any digital media. While just a quick point to add is that even for people without a smartphone, there is a payment mechanism. The awareness of it is very low. The USSD mechanism to make an IMPS transfer, it requires a standard code like a star hash, 99 hash kind of a code is to be sent to transfer money. The knowledge of it is very low. Maybe the lending companies can look at, you know, giving a good detailed instructions along with it when they ask for the recovery angle to be done. So that's how I would kind of liquidate it. Technology plus psychology, both of this needs to play very well together for the recollections part to be made more modern now.
I would like to add to that also, yes. Shashank, very well put. Muthu, the key thing is that, yes, when we went to the market also, initially we thought the adoption of digital payments or this kind of, you know, neobanking and this awareness and the usage would be very low in the tier 2, tier 3 cities. But to our surprise, today we serve almost 12,000 PIN codes in India. And offline businesses have also adopted very, very well. And this is one of the areas where, as Shashank also rightly mentioned, you could probably look at, you know, this is where API banking or these kind of things become extremely handy, wherein you can find out options which you can integrate to your system and provide all kind of solutions as a cash management collection system to your customers.
Thank you. Next question we have from Manish Jivani. Can we have his audio, please? Manish Jivani.
Hello.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, Manisha. Please go ahead.
Yeah, so I just wanted to know that nowadays a lot of fintechs are resorting to pivoting their business. I wanted to understand the opinion of how this will impact and how pivoting will play an important role, and like how does it work? So this is something that I wanted to understand.
Okay. All right. Meghna, you want to take that?
Sure. I think that startups have to be very, very nimble and also learn, in their journey, right? So pivoting sometimes can be quite instrumental. If you take Myntra, for example, they were selling T-shirts and cups, and they pivoted to selling, you know, garments and apparel, and that was a very good pivot, right? Even CreditWatch per se, we started with serving law firms as our first product, and which was more compliance oriented. And in 2016, we pivoted to giving risk insights using data, and that's something we learned when we spoke to our customers when our product initially hit the market and we got feedback. So pivoting is good, provided it's a well thought through strategy. Now, just because there's a COVID crisis going on, suddenly pivoting to do something in relation to COVID, which is a complete deviation from what you're doing today. Those kind of pivots are not recommended. A pivot should be very well thought through. You should be nimble. You should adapt. But don't kind of just pivot just for the sake of pivoting, or pivot because there's a COVID situation. So suddenly I'll start offering services in relation to the COVID, just because that's the opportunity where that might not be the strength of what you're doing. So it needs to be a well thought through strategy.
Anyone else would want to add about pivoting the situation?
So I would probably like to touch upon the finance angle as well here, because what happens is today the pivot can be of two things. So this is where it's critical to understand the shift in behavior that's going to happen during the short term and even as a permanency. So we should really cut to the chase and see what kind of things would, behavior change, will stay with us for a longer time. And if the assets you have built is going to be extremely useful to cater to the new normal, then it makes sense to do a pivot because you are playing, leveraging on your core strength. So that is, that would also help you stay stronger or rather emerge stronger. So there is no problem in doing such a pivot. But as Meghna mentioned, doing it as a knee-jerk reaction is something which we should avoid.
The next question that we have is from Prakhar Deulia. Can we have his audio, please? Prakhar.
Hi. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Prakhar. I work with Mahindra Automotive Division. Just wanted to check with you in current scenario where, you know, automobile sales and service both are, you know, not happening. And so do you see fintech startups or this thing catering to the dealer fraternity where online getting retail customer can have a lot of options in Bank Bazaar or Paisa Bazaar where he can, but I don't see that happening for SME or a dealer fraternity. Secondly, automation of the supply chain finance. So dealer or SME deals with the banks and then there is a separate tie-up, then the money comes into OEM and then the billing happens or the dispatch of the vehicles happens. But there is no one integrated ecosystem where each and every three parties which are involved, dealer, OEM, and the financer, can see a transaction straight through.
Mithun, Satyam, you would want to take this?
Sure. But I think the problems you raise in terms of friction are perfectly valid questions, right? And I think these have been both sort of affecting transaction flows and reducing the size of the industry per se. We're trying to approach it in two fronts. I think number one, from a public perspective, from the government perspective, there are a bunch of efforts underway to be able to make transactions for SMEs a little more seamless, right? There is a Beam for Lending app that's on the way to get happening. You all would have heard of Account Aggregator anyway. Right now, there's a little bit of a delay in timeline given what's happening because of COVID. But when these things were to come online, you would potentially find that the transaction friction that has existed in the past goes away. Whether it results in a Paisa Bazaar like or a Bank Bazaar like platform, which allows for, you know, marketplace or multiple products, is it large enough to create that? Depends to be seen. Unsure. Even today, by the way, a lot of MSMEs show up on a Paisa Bazaar and a Bank Bazaar as well, at least speaking for their credit and lending needs. I don't know for the other requirements altogether. Now, second piece, which you said in terms of creating a single unified force for something like a automobile loan or a OEM lending loan. Sure, valuable. How valuable is it to create and how much will it actually change the industry altogether? Not sure, which is probably why, you know, a player hasn't sort of taken up and done it yet, because if there was value to be, significant value to be created by that, somebody would have done it for the cost to benefit outcome. But given that maybe people are willing to bear with some pain in order to get their loan, it has not yet been created, is how I see it, right? Even when a Bank Bazaar launched, I mean, how many years back? It was close to, I think, 12 years back, when a Paisa Bazaar sort of started out, none of the products that they were offering were new, and there existed agents in the market which had a similar sense of a marketplace. Now they've just reduced the friction, and for a large enough consumer opportunity, it has made sense to reduce that friction. For the 70 million MSME opportunity, will it actually do that? Don't know. A player could actually start out and do it. Today, when we at Lending Card go to business, while our core product is credit, we allow the customer who has come there to be able to pick a whole bunch of products that we offer, which are not our own products, right? Things which other customers, other companies do. We don't offer gold loans, but we offer gold loans through a partner who sort of, you know, goes and offers the gold loans to them. We offer insurance to our customers, both for the loans that they take and sort of general insurance, none of which, we are not an insurance company. We just offer it as a sales agent. So are we now a marketplace? Sure, to an extent we are. And I think as customers come and make their first transactions with, you know, a trusted partner, they'll be willing to hear 20 other recommendations on that, and hopefully with that, the friction goes down.
So to speak specifically to automobile ecosystem, you know, this dominated, the structure is dominated by the large players. So like a Mahindra and Mahindra, okay. The entire dealer chain of Mahindra and Mahindra is commanded by Mahindra itself first, okay. So unless until it is, these initiatives are taken from that front, it will be very difficult for fintechs to to enter a provide a chain-based solution or an automation. The reason being is that, you know, as an institution, whether it's a Maruti or a Tata or a Mahindra, based on their rating, they command a very different pricing power with the large banks. And the design of those relationships are that the banks force them that the dealer should take the finance from those banks, even if it is ineffective. So, you know, there is a structural jams which has been created by the giants over there. And it becomes very difficult in those kind of situations to seep in and build an ecosystem or a product. So, because when I go to a dealer, okay, so the dealer says that, hey, I mean, the SBI gives me at a 10%. Now, SBI might be giving on a certain category of product which comes from a Maruti. It doesn't give for anyone. But the expectation, the wrong expectation is set in the system. So do we do certain loans? Yes, we do certain loans. As I was saying, on a certain category, we have started taking the leadership in those categories. Are the product or the chain necessity, the automation or the entire tech blocks necessity? The answer is yes. But it cannot be done without the principal support. The principal support has to be the large manufacturers who command the OEM dictation, the terms and policies, or the dealer dictation in terms of terms, policy, vehicle sale, and everything. Because any of this system has to actually plug in to your CRM, your purchase management system, your sales system, your purchase management system in terms of OEM, your sales management system in terms of the dealer supply chain, where each and every part has to be looked at. The data has to feed into my system the way it works in a B2B sales environment. So that when it comes to a B2B, the organization has been more open. But when it comes to vehicles, the organizations are not yet shown the openness.
All right, thank you, Satyam. So we've just run out of time. We'll just take one more question before we wrap up for today. The last question from Pawan Laksh. Pawan Laksh.
Hi, sir. Hello?
Yes, Pawan, go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Very good afternoon. Myself, Pawan Laksh. Sir, I'm a finance aggregator, startup actually, Dial Your Bank. Okay. My question is that actually how gonna the lending process, like we are going to the aggressive in the market, like my major concentration is on unorganized sector, like we have a tie with an Incred and this Clicks Capital, Neo Growth, because they are funding for the unorganized sector, like a swiping based banking based surrogate rate. Okay, and the prospect we gonna concentrate, sir, if you can help me out, it would be better, sir.
Okay. Not sure whom should I give this one to, but
Mithun sir would be better. Because he's into a lending, right?
Yeah.
No, fair enough. I'm not sure I got the exact purport of the question. Were you saying, will we be aggressive in the future in the market or not? Was that the question?
So he wants to know that whether he should be aggressive because he works in the unorganized sector, you know, lending in the organized sector.
Okay, so. I think, fair question, sir. But I think, universally right now, whether unorganized, organized, wherever we might be, I think the ask of the day is to be prudent and not aggressive is my overall guidance. And I think definitely in a thing like unorganized and sort of, you know, informal sort of unsecure system, I would at this point, at least the next 6 months, the market would reward and your business would be well rewarded to be more prudent than aggressive. Where I would be aggressive is on sort of building capability and doubling down on the product. I think Meghna spoke a bit about transitioning through a difficult time. If you're tight on cash, find a flat valuation, go deeper on your product, understand your customer more, if need be, innovate, etc., and then come back in a year to sort of be more aggressive and think about it. That's roughly the mind frame that I would keep. And this is not limited to lending, but I think definitely so in lending. That's at least how I'm approaching the next 6 months for lending card, which is given the size that we are at. And we've typically doubled every year for the last 4 years. But this year, the market will reward us. And I think it's also a right thing to do for people who invest in us to look at the year in a much more prudent manner as opposed to an aggressive manner.
So, Saurabh, let me just add on to that. So, Pawan, you will have to broad-base your supply ecosystem, because being an intermediary, you have to understand that you have to solve the problem for your customer. And for solving the problem of your customers, the traditional institutions with which you have been working might be a bit tepid in their response, or they'll be guarded in their response. You should also look forward to work with some of the P2P player, P2P NBFCs, and I think one of them, the leading one is, or the larger balance sheet player is a FairSend, because you really want people to come forward and support the businesses wherever there is a genuine requirement, which goes beyond the traditional way of underwriting. So the thought process will be to broad-base your supply network or the matchmaking on the supply side.
All right. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, so much. We have a lot of questions, but we have really run out of time. So, Siddharth, Shashank, Tina, Meghna, Mithun, and Satyam, I'm sure it was very helpful for our attendees here, and thank you for joining us. As I see that, you know, despite a lot being said, I see that the fintech industry is quite geared up to take on the situation. The silos are broken down. Breaking down, so we'll have collaborative approach, and as Siddharth also said, that you know, a little bit of push from the government if we get if the industry gets, and not only the fintech sector but the entire SME and the small businesses sector with benefit. And Shashank added that, you know, they are working on newer business models and everything. Mithun Satyam added that we need to be prudent in whatever we do right now and try to just hang in there. So thank you everyone so much. It was great to have you all here for our webinar, and hope to see you again soon. And I would also like to thank our attendees for being here. Just a request, at the end of the session, there will be a short form, survey form. If you can just fill that in, it will help us improve our offering in the future. Thank you so much, everyone. Stay safe, stay well.